Today we're going to be talking about the fundamentals of electromagnetism, namely Maxwell's equations, and we will see how those, at first glance, rather simple equations lead to electromagnetic waves, and we are going to take a closer look at those waves. We're going to see some of their properties and what they differ by compared to the generic waves we were considering. And as a conclusion, we will get to some very important applications that they have for communication, and we'll get to some very important general properties which we'll later on see when considering antennas, emission, receiving, and so on. And so, I can show you Maxwell's equations right away. I can write the four equations which you could say govern 1/4 of the fundamental physics, which govern electromagnetism, but what do they really mean? For those of you who are quite familiar with vector and tensor calculus, they will be quite obvious, I hope, but for those of you who are still new to the field, for those who are not yet versed in the mathematical preliminaries, we can take a short look and we can take a detour and get some intuition of what those equations tell us and understand them at least heuristically, at least intuitively, even without knowing all of the math behind them. And so let's take a look first at what the main players in those equations are. So what we call fields, what we call vector fields. Now, the E and the B in the equations are actually the electric field and the magnetic induction. But what is a field? What do we call a vector field? Well, much like a function, the vector field is something which has its input, a point in space, but unlike a simple function, its output is not simply a value which corresponds to this point, but it's a whole direction. And so it's an arrow in a sense. You could think of vector fields as a field of arrows, each of which giving you a direction and a magnitude. And so at each point in space, a vector field assigns a vector. In that sense, you could think of them as the arrows corresponding to flow lines of the fields themselves. So in the picture I'm showing, for example, if you take all of these arrows and you connect them, you can form what is known as integral curves of the vector field, and you can form what you can think of as flow. And so a vector field, in intuitive sense, is actually something describing a flow. It's something describing how things change over space and also time. But mathematically, if you like, you can consider it as being a set of functions. So you have a function for the x component, a function for the y component, and a function for the z component, each of which being independent. In contrast, a simple function has only one component, so it gives you just one number for each point in space. Well, again, as stated, a vector field gives you three numbers for each point in three-dimensional space. So in a sense, it is a vector-valued function. Now, we will be using vector fields to describe the electric and magnetic field, but we're also going to see some operators in the equations. In fact, you might have been scared by the mean-looking div and grad or curl which you're seeing on the slide, but these are just some differential operators which are formed by what we can think of as a differential vector, a derivative vector. It is known as the nabla operator, and you can see it's each of its components is the partial derivative with respect to that direction. So its x component is partial derivative with respect to x, and so on. Now, if we take this nabla operator, which is a differential operator, and use it on a vector field or on a simple function through a specific operation, we get the three most widely used differential operators in physics in general. And those are the gradient, the divergence, and the curl. And so the gradient is simply nabla acting on a function, while the divergence is nabla scalarly, or if you like, dot product with a vector field, and the curl is nabla acting with a vector product on the vector field. And so these three arithmetic operations paired with this one differential operator give us those three fundamental differential operators which we're going to be using from now on. And just to give you a sense of what they mean, to give you some interpretation, the gradient of a function, it's an operator which takes a function and turns it into a vector. So the gradient of a function, the gradient of a one component thing, gives us three components, respectively the derivative with respect to x, the derivative with respect to y, and the derivative with respect to z, to all three axis labels. And so the interpretation is actually which is the direction in which the function changes the most. So if you had a simple function in three dimensions, so to each point there corresponds a certain value, if you took the gradient of that function, it would be an arrow pointing you to the direction in which the function is changing the most. And so if you were on top of a mountain and you asked for the gradient, since now, if you had a perfectly level mountain, since there is no change in any direction, the gradient would be simply zero. In fact, whenever the gradient is zero, there is a high probability of having a maximum or a minimum of the function. But again, the general intuition that you should have about it is that it's an arrow pointing in the direction that the function changes the most. And, as we said, it takes a normal function or a scalar and turns it into a vector. Now, the next differential operator we spoke about, the divergence, is quite the opposite in that sense. So it takes a vector and it turns it into a scalar, turns it into a normal function. And how does it act? Well, we said that it acts by dot product, and if you recall, a dot product is simply a sum of all the different combinations. And so it's the sum of all of those partial derivatives of the respective components of the vector field. Now, the intuitive thought what divergence is actually, it tells you how many sources there are in a point. So the divergence of a vector field in a given point tells you how much the field lines, or how much the arrows come out of this point or come into this point. So if the divergence is negative, the certain point is called a sink, because all of the arrows, all of the fields are converging to it and they're entering it, much like water is entering the sink. However, if the divergence is positive, what we get is a source. So stuff is coming out of this point. Now you can see those two scenarios on the slide, and you can also see the third case in which the divergence is simply zero. Now in that case, there are as many arrows entering the point as there are exiting it, and so the point is neither a source nor a sink. So there is no divergence at all. There is nothing coming out of it, nothing going into it. Stuff is just passing by. And in that sense, if you think of a vector field as a velocity field of a liquid, you could exactly get the analogy with the sink I was talking about. Now, the last operator is the curl, sometimes known as the rotor. And what it tells you, as the name suggests, is how much the vector field curls on itself. So a vector field which has no beginning and no end, so no sources, but is just rotating around itself, will have a non-zero curl. On the other hand, a vector field which has a single source and is coming out, like the one we saw previously, it will have a divergence but not a curl. And so here we're seeing a vector field which has only a curl, it has no divergence since there are no sources. You can see on the plot that there are no points where the arrows are coming out of or going into, they're simply circling around and coming back in the same position. And so, in that sense, the curl gives you how much the vector field rotates, if you like, in space. And unlike the other two operators, which turned a function into a vector or a vector into a function, the curl takes a vector and turns it into a vector again. To be perfectly precise, it turns it into a pseudo-vector, but for our intents and purposes, we will make no distinction between the two, and you can look at the supplementary material to understand what that means. Now, looking again at Maxwell's equations, we can finally decipher what they mean. Keeping in mind the interpretations we just gave of gradient, of curl, and of divergence, and keeping in mind what the different quantities mean, just to get a brief look, E, as you said, is the electric field vector, B, as you said, is the magnetic induction vector, rho is the charge density, so it tells us how much charge there is per unit volume in a given point, while J is the current density, so it tells us how much current passes through that point per given volume. And so, just to make one important distinction, rho is a scalar, which means that charge density is simply a function. So you can have positive charge, negative charge, but it doesn't have a direction, whereas J, which is the current density, is a vector. So it has both a magnitude and a direction. This is true because if I tell you that there is a current passing through a given point, I don't really tell you much because it could be pointing in any direction. It could be passing from left to right or from down to up. And so J should be a vector to give us the full information of the current. Now, those constants you see here, epsilon and mu, they're actually fundamental properties of vacuum, and we will not really be taking much consideration into them. They are simply constants which can be well measured from experiments, so we will not really take them into much consideration here. Now, let's look at the first equation. What it tells us is that the divergence of the electric field is equal to the charge density up to an accuracy of a constant. So what does that tell us? Well, first of all, it tells us that the electric field has divergence, which is non-zero. So it has sources. It has what is known as static sources. And second, it links the divergence of the electric field to the charge density. And so if we have positive charge somewhere, it tells us that electric lines, electric field lines, are going to come out of it. So positive charge creates electric field. In a sense, the lines are flowing out of it. Now, what it tells us again is that if we have negative charge, we said if we have negative divergence, that we have a sink. So negative charges, on the other hand, they take in the vector field. And so a positive charge is a source, so the electric field comes out of it, while the negative charge is a sink, so electric field flows into it. And so if we have two charges, a positive and negative, we would expect that the field lines would start from the positive and enter the negative. So the importance of this equation, it tells us that we have sources of the electric field which are static, and so having a simple charge somewhere produces electric field. Now, on the other hand, a contrast appears, since the magnetic field turns out to have a divergence zero. And this is a very fundamental statement. It tells us that there are no static charges with the magnetic field. It tells us that we cannot get simply a magnetic field coming out of some point, only having a north or a south pole. This is a very important statement for physics, and it tells us that there are no magnetic monopoles. And so any magnet will always have north and south pole. We cannot cut it, we cannot divide it in any way. This equation essentially tells us that we cannot get the same configuration that we get with the electric field, namely a charge and vector field coming out of it or into it for the magnetic fields. Now, the third equation is very important as it links the two. It's the first hint that there is a link between electric field and magnetic induction. And it tells us that the curl of the electric field is depending on the time derivative of the magnetic field. And so, deciphering what this means, it tells us that if there is a changing magnetic field, so if the magnetic field is oscillating or changing somehow, what we get is the creation of an electric field. And in fact, the minus sign tells us the direction. So if the magnetic field is increasing, the electric field will be decreasing and vice versa. So the two are connected and one can create the other. Now, this is our first hint that they're really one and the same. And we'll later see that they are really one and the same. They're described by the same potential, for potential. And in a sense, the distinction between electric and magnetic field is more or less a relic of what we have thought of them before. They're really one and the same. And this is why the branch is known as electromagnetism. We make no distinction in them in fundamental physics. Now, the difference between the electric field produced by the changing magnetic field and the electric field we considered before is that this one has a curl. This one is not a divergent electric field, so it does not have a point charge with electric lines coming out of it or into it, but it is rotating in a sense. It's a closed loop electric field. And so the change in magnetic field creates loop electric fields, much like the magnetic fields we're used to in a permanent magnet. Now, what we see in the fourth equation is something very similar with a small addition. So let's first decipher the term on the right, which says that the change in the electric field, again up to some constants, creates the curl of the magnetic field. Now, this tells us pretty much the same thing we saw previously, except in reverse. So now, if we have a changing electric field, this will give rise to a magnetic field, but not divergent magnetic field, not a field which has a point source or anything like that, but again, closed loop magnetic field. And so we see that the magnetic field, as its sources may be two, we see the variable electric field, or the second term, which is on the left actually, which is the current density. But we see that both of them, they give rise to curl B. So what we note from this equation is that the magnetic fields are always closed loop. So since the divergence of the magnetic field is always zero, this was the second equation, but its curl is non-zero, this means that a magnetic field will always be closed loop. So you cannot get a magnetic field which starts somewhere and ends somewhere else. It is always a closed loop. And you may think of the permanent magnet and ask, wait, but isn't that an open loop? Like we have a north pole, things start from it and they end on the south pole. Well, not really, because all of those lines, all of those field lines, they close inside the magnet. And so all of the field lines are actually closed loops. And a permanent magnet, again, it is not a static configuration. In fact, what causes the magnetism it has is the motion of the electrons or the spins of the electrons. And so in a sense, it is not the same as the positive and negative charges, which are indeed static sources of electric field. But the permanent magnet is simply something with non-zero current density inside. So the magnetic field is, again, a closed loop field. Now, these four equations, they may look quite abstract to you at this point. At least I hope that you get the basic intuitive idea of what they describe. But what we're actually going to be working with, we will not be going much deeper into them. We're only going to consider them in vacuum. And why is that? Is because in vacuum they have a very peculiar and very simple looking solution. Now first let's just look at them in vacuum. What does it mean? Well, it means that there are no charges and no currents. Vacuum means that there are no external sources. So taking the rho term, which was the charge density, and J term, which was the current density, taking them as being zero, so being in perfect vacuum, we get a much more symmetrical system. So you see right now we have divergence E and B both equaling zero, and we have very symmetrical right-hand side. So the curl of E is proportional to the derivative of B, and the curl of B is proportional to the derivative of E. Those constants there are not really important for our considerations right now, but we're going to see that they actually lead to the speed of the wave solutions, which we're going to see in the next slide. However, even at this point, before looking at any mathematics, we can immediately see that there is a connection between the two, and we can see the duality at this point. Why? Because the change in magnetic field creates electric field, but this change in electric field produces then magnetic field. And this thing is like a closed loop, it's like a cycle. So variable electric field will give rise to variable magnetic field, and vice versa. The variable magnetic field will give rise to the variable electric field. And in fact, this is the beauty of these equations, and this is the fact why electromagnetic waves propagate through vacuum and why they do not need additional media. The fact is that they, in a sense, create each other, the electromagnetic fields, they, in a sense, perpetuate each other, and they keep going. The decay of one creates the other and vice versa, and so the electromagnetic wave, in a sense, is a stable oscillation of those fields, which does not really go down, it does not really require an external media, and once it's emitted, it just keeps going by itself. And so, just to give you a quick hint of the things to come, this is what the solutions are. The simplest form of the solutions are a sine wave for the electric field and a sine wave for the magnetic field. Respectively, the two E0 and B0 vectors are the amplitudes, or if you like, the directions of the amplitudes, and we're going to see in a while that they have some very nice properties and they have very well defined geometry, the two fields. But at this point, what we see is a viable solution is exactly what we described as being a wave previously, with one small difference, which is the fact that the wave number is now a wave vector. So we are not working in one dimension anymore, we're working in three dimensions. And so k is no longer just a number, it's now a vector, and the sign in front of it does not simply tell us left or right, it tells us along the line of propagation or in the opposite direction. So k is the vector which gives us the direction of propagation of the wave itself, and this simplest vacuum solution gives us a hint of the existence of electromagnetic waves.